Very good morning, students. I welcome you to final year and to our first class of pharmacognosy, which is on saponin glycosides. Now, saponin glycosides is a chapter which we have dealt in the first year, and what I'm going to do is first revise with you all and then go ahead with the next aspect. We will see the definition, the properties, the chemical test, then the last part, which is the classification. Now, what is the definition? Saponins, we know, are soap forming compounds. Soap, that is, they are surface active properties, and they form a persistent froth when we shake it with water. Now, remember, the difference is the word persistent. Any compound, when we add in water and we shake, we will get a foam. But when we add a saponin to water and we shake it, this foam will remain constant for 1 minute. Hence, we use the word persistent. Because of this property of saponin, it is used as a detergent in cosmetic industry. There's another one more property of saponin, which is also used in cosmetic industry, and that is because of its toxicity to cold-blooded animals. And how is it toxic to cold-blooded animals? It causes hemolysis of the red blood cells, that is, it breaks down the RBCs of what? Of small insects. So, if you remember, we have shikakai, which is very, very important saponin. If you shake it, it produces foam, and it is also used in the treatment of lice in the shampoos. So, why? Because it causes hemolysis of the red blood cells of the lice, of those small insects. Another property of saponin is because of its chemical structure, and the chemical structure of saponin is that of a steroidal in nature. Because of the steroidal nature of saponin, it is used as a starting material for the semisynthesis of steroidal drugs. What is the function of saponin in plants? Now, this saponin in plants also, it has a role. It is not just because it is used in industry by us, but in plants, it is present in organelles which have a very high metabolic turnover. And because of which, we can say it is a very, very physiologically significant important constituent of the plant. And its main function is to protect the plant against fungal attack. And how does it do? Now, these saponins means they are saponin glycosides. That is, they have a sugar. Now, if the sugar is one, if there is one sugar present, it is called as monodesmosidic derivatives. And if there are two sugars present in two different positions, I am talking about bides means they are present in two different positions in the structure, it is called as bidesmosidic saponins. Okay? Now, these bidesmosidic saponins obviously are more soluble in water because they have two sugar molecules, and therefore they act as a typical, they do not have the typical properties of a saponin, but it acts as a transport media. So, it transports the saponins wherever it is produced. For example, if it is produced in the roots, it transports it from the root to the area where the plant tissue is damaged. For example, if the plant, the leaves are damaged because of the fungus, then these saponins are transported to the leaves. In the leaves, the plant tissue releases an enzyme because of its being damaged. The enzyme then breaks down the bidesmosidic saponins into monodesmosidic derivatives, which then acts as a defense against the microbial attacks. So, that is the function of saponin in plants. Remember, it is for their own defense mechanism, especially for the fungal attack. The properties of saponins are, it is soluble in water, in alcohol and in hydroalcoholic mixture. The ergglycones are called as sapogenins. They also enhance the absorption of other drugs and they form a complex with cholesterol. Let's go into the classification of saponins. And the classification of saponins are, first, they are classified into two important parts. One is the steroidal saponins, and second is the triterpenoidal saponins. If you recollect, we have done this classification even in the first year wherein we also saw the chemical test which differentiates the steroidal saponins from the triterpenoidal saponins. And this is the Liberman-Burchard's test. What does Liberman-Burchard's test do? Liberman-Burchard's test contains acetic anhydride and sulfuric acid. So when we add the erglycone with acetic anhydride plus H2SO4, the steroidal saponins, what they do? They become green color with Liberman-Burchard, and the triterpenoidal ones become pinkish or red color with Liberman-Burchard. So we had done this under chemical classification also in our third year. So steroidal saponins, triterpenoidal saponins, these are the classes of saponins. We have a third class which is called as the steroidal amines. These are nothing but steroidal alkaloids which behave like saponins. Okay, they behave like saponins. You can see they are amines, means they are nitrogen containing compounds, so they are also called as steroidal alkaloids. So they are pseudo alkaloids. We will see them under alkaloids chapter. Now let's focus on these two, steroidal saponins and triterpenoidal saponins. Another difference between them is mainly steroidal saponins are present in monocot plants, that is in agave, Dioscorea, fenugreek, tobacco, whereas the triterpenoidal saponins are present in dicot plant, and the best example was licorice, that is jeshrama, shikakai, that is acacia concinnata, okay. So areta, these are all your examples of triterpenoidal saponins. Now let's see the further classification of steroidal saponins. Now these steroidal saponins are C27 compounds. See, they have C27 carbon atoms. Let's see how there are C27 carbon atoms first. You see here we have the steroidal structure. A steroidal structure means you have 19 carbons. So 17 goes over here. This is 18th carbon. This is the 19th carbon. Here we have 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, and the CH3 is the 27th carbon. So we have observed that there are 27 carbon atoms and there are 6 rings. Now 4 rings we know is usually present in a steroidal structure. We have now the 5th ring and the 6th ring. Now how is this formed? This 5th ring and 6th ring is formed because of the intramolecular ketalization. I'm going slow. Intramolecular ketalization, which occurs at the 16th position. This is our 16th position. This is our 22nd position. And this is our 26th position. Let's repeat the structure. See here, this is my 18th carbon. This is my 19th carbon. This was my 17th carbon. This is my 16th carbon. So 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Okay, so intramolecular ketalization between the 16th carbon and the 26th carbon gives you this structure. Again, intramolecular ketalization between the 22nd one and the 26th. What is 26? This is 22, 23, 24, 25, and 26. So, intramolecular ketalization between the 22nd and the 26th carbon. This is my 26th carbon. This one, 26th carbon, gives me the 6th ring. Am I clear? So we have the 5 ring structure, which is called as the furostenol, and the 6 ring structure, which is called as the spirostenol. So the pentacyclic one is called as the furostenol, and the hexacyclic one is called as the spirostain. Hexacyclic spirostain, pentacyclic furostain. The steroidal class drugs are further classified into furostenol and spirostenol type of saponins. How to draw the structure? We will see when we take the class. So do not worry, don't be bothered, such a big structure, but you know we can always do it fast when we will study. So don't bother about the structure, only remember my words. Steroidal classification further classified as furostain and spirostain. Now coming to the SAR, the structure activity or how are all the structures different in this part. Once you know the structure, all the other structures are very simple. Now, what are the major things which happen? Now, listen here. First is this fifth position. This is fifth position, how? Right? You all know how this is fifth position. This is my 1, this is my 2, this is my 3, this is my 4, this is my 5. Okay? Now, if there are three things which can happen at the fifth position. In the fifth position, there could be a double bond here. If there is a double bond here, if there's a double bond here, it would be a 5 and a 6 double bond. And if there is no double bond, we can have either a 5 alpha hydrogen or a 5 beta hydrogen. Alpha hydrogen, dotted lines, beta hydrogen, thick lines. So three types of structures are possible. One with a 5-6 double bond, second with a 5 alpha hydrogen, third with a 5 beta hydrogen. So 5 alpha hydrogen example is tigogenine, 5 beta hydrogen example is smilagenine. Okay. Now coming to the second place where there can be a structural modification, that is this 25th carbon. Okay. Remember, this was our 26th carbon which formed the ketal. So this was my 25th carbon and this CH3 is my 27th carbon. Now at this 25th carbon, we can have two types of configuration. One is 25S pyrostain, which is axial methyl, and 25R pyrostain, which is equatorial methyl. So here again, we have two types of modification, 25S and 25R. 25S is called as pyrostain, axial methyl, sapogenin, and 25R is isosapogenin. So these are the two important places where there can be structural modification. The remaining is the same. The configuration at C20 and 22 is always S and R. The BC and the CD ring are the B and the C and the C and the D are always transfused. So these remain the same. What is important is my these two parts. Fine. Let's go ahead. That is, now we complete with the steroidal classification. We complete with the steroidal classification, pyrostenol type and the furostenol type. Now let's see the triterpenoidal saponins. The triterpenoidal saponins are further classified into 11 classes. But three of them are important. One is damerane, second is oleanine, and third is ursines. Damerane, oleanine, and ursines. Now let's see what are these three. Damerane, oleanine, and ursines. Now these are mainly pentacyclic. Let's first focus on this. Oleanine and ursine. These are pentacyclic structures. Usually the triterpenoids are pentacyclic. That is, oleanines and ursines, we can see they are pentacyclic. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. All are 6-membered structures. How to draw the structure? Again, very easy. We will see that in the class. Now, for the time being, remember, under triterpenoidal class, we have the pentacyclic type, which is the oleanines and ursines. The difference is only this part. You can see here, both the CH3 on one carbon here. We have both the CH3s on different carbons. And the second is the tetracyclic. The tetracyclic saponin, which is the damerane. So, triterpenoidal saponins are divided into two types, 11 classes. But out of those 11 classes, three are important. One is the damerane, second is the oleanine, and third is the ursine. The difference between damerane, oleanine, and ursine, damerane is a 4-membered ring, tetracyclic, whereas oleanines and ursines are 5-membered rings. This is not a steroidal ring. Remember, this is H, not CH3. So, it is not a steroidal ring. So, for now, let's summarize it as we have seen the definition, the role, the chemical test and the classification. Further, how to draw the structures and other things we will do when we take the class. Please go through this before we come up to the class. Thank you.